Welcome to ZAT 2021, how to crack the ZAT. Okay, let's start with the basic things first. You know, what is a ZAT? So ZAT is a test with scores that are accepted by XLRI and other institutes. Other institutes include GYM and so on. There used to be earlier SPGMIR, which they're not accepting this year. So that has changed. So now, online since the last 2 years, 18, 19, 20, that is last 3 years, ZAT has been online. This will be the fourth version, 2021. We don't expect the structure to change too much. Well, but ZAT is always a test which is known for surprises. So you can't say that it will definitely not change. We don't expect it to change. Chances are very, very low. So let's first talk about the structure quickly. I know if you're preparing for ZAT, you all must have gone through. But assume that out of the 1,500 students over here, some of you all don't know the structure. So let's quickly go through the structure. Part A, Part B. Part A is 165 minutes, 75 questions, which includes verbal ability and reading comprehension. Some also call it LR also there. There is LR also there. But that's not your LR which you are asked in CAT. 26 questions there. Decision making, 21 questions. That's the new section. So a lot of people, you know, would agree with me that a lot of time decision making is the make or break section in ZAT. People who do well here are the ones who normally go to XLR. Then there is quantitative ability and DI, pure DI. So we'll talk about that also. 28 questions there. Regular marking scheme plus one minus 0.25. Why is it minus 0.25 and not like a 0.33 like CAT? Because there are 5 options, right? Because that is a 5-option exam. Part B, yeah, I'm going to talk about the negative marking for unattempted questions also, just wait. Part B will have general awareness questions. You can call it GK, general awareness. There's a breakup of GK, static GK and current affairs. We'll talk about that also. 25 marks, 25 questions, 25 marks. Very importantly, no negative marking. Since there is no negative marking, you're definitely going to attempt all these questions. Please don't miss out anything, right? Okay, so overall 100 questions, you have 3 hours. The test is from 9:30 to 12:30, only in one slot. I'm sure after the CAT debacle, I would not say debacle, but where I would say first time, the difficulty level across the 3 slots was not standard. This is a welcome change. ZAT is happening only in one slot. Okay. So 100 questions overall to be answered in 3 hours, 165 minutes over here. Now, very important, very, very important. Everybody please pay attention to this. Part A, there's a negative 0.1 after the first 8 questions for every unattempted question. Now, what does this mean? Let's say part A, as we said, there are 75 questions and the pattern does not change. And you have attempted, say, 35 questions, right? Which means there are 40 unattempted questions. As per last year, the rule was for the first eight questions, there'll be no negative marking for the unattempted ones you're talking about, right? See, for the questions that you get wrong, you're definitely going to get negative marking. But for the ones which you have unattempted, suppose 40 questions are there, which means based on 0.1, you're going to get 4 marks negative. If you're not attempted 40 questions, you're going to get 4 negative marks. This 4 marks will be distributed in the 3 sections in this ratio of the questions. So approximately 1/3. Obviously, DM will be slightly lesser, but approximately 1/3. Now, this is the important part. Everybody needs to understand this well. So I hope you're clear here. I'm just going to take maybe a question or two over here. Ayushi, first 8 questions of the whole paper, not of the section. Yes, the timer starts separately. The timer will start separately. There will be 100 questions. They changed it last year from 99 to 100. Okay. Well, one question here and there is not going to make too much of a difference. There will be mostly 100 questions. But you all should read this rule very carefully when you go to the test. This rule keeps changing every year. Earlier, they used to have 12 questions. Now, they made it 8. Now, my logic to this is don't worry about this part too much. Still, do not attempt the questions which you don't know. Because what happens is, it is better to get a negative 0.1 than to rather than get a negative 0.25. Okay? So, yeah, if you have reached, narrowed down to maybe 2 options, you can take a chance. Yes, if you have not marked an answer, I'll explain this whole part again once more. Everybody, please be quiet. About the part where you can skip the sections and all, I'm going to come to that. So please hold on to your horses. Just wait for those questions to come. I'm going to explain this again. So for example, if you have totally 75 questions in this part A, at the end of your 165 minutes, if you have attempted 35 questions, which means you have not attempted 40 questions, for the first 8 questions, there'll be no negative marking. That means for the remaining 32 questions, the negative marking will be 32 into negative 0.1, which will be negative 3.2, which will get divided in the ratio of these three, 26, 21, and 25. Approximately 1/3. Just take it approximately 1/3 because it is going to be much less than that. So finally, assume it is going to be 1.1 marks. Even with 40 unattempted questions, it's going to be 1.1 mark per section. Right? So my suggestion to you would be, don't get too much carried away into attempting questions because of this rule. I feel that has made this rule so students attempt more questions and get more negative marking. They want to segregate the smart students from the dumb ones. Here, the dumb ones will be those category who will go and start attempting too many questions. Is that part clear now? Are we clear with this whole thing about the negative marking? Okay, great. Moving ahead. No negative marking for the first 8. Okay. Part B scores. Now, this is the part a lot of people ask. Part B scores not used for percentile calculation. So, your percentile does not depend on your GK scores. Understand this very simple. So let's assume you're taking your ZAT scores and you're going to apply to GIM, Goa Institute of Management. Very frankly, your Part B score will not even impact it because Part B scores are not used for percentiles. Part B scores will be used only by XLRI during the interview round. So let's pay attention to that. Yeah. Now let's look at the percentile cutoff over the last 2 years. For the female category, the male category, it's there on the screen for a minute. I would suggest you take a snapshot because I'm sure you're going to ask me to do this later. So Part B scores, look at the ZAT cutoffs carefully. Just wait a minute. I will answer the questions. So first take a snapshot and go through this very carefully. Yes, we will come to marks versus percentile mapping also. Just wait. Yes, for every section, I'm going to do that separately and we'll do an overall thing also. Okay, let's start with this. Yes, there are definitely sectional cutoffs. So, if you look at your scores, overall scores, where are your scores there? So, if you look at what's happening, this is a percentile cutoff. These are not scores. These are talking about percentile. That is, what is the percentile cutoff required? So 85 percentile in quant was what was there in 2020, 78 in DM and 74 in BALR. And this is for BM, For HR, it falls a little bit. You can see specifically for HR, the verbal score goes up, DM goes down, and even quant goes down. Quant goes down drastically. So for all those who are interested in HR, you need to worry about verbal a lot more than quant, right? For females, the percentiles go down a little bit more by 2 percentile approximately. For DM, maybe by 4 percentile also. No, it's not because of the flagship program is HR. Now, let me tell you something about XLRI. XLRI is an excellent, excellent college to go for any program. So if somebody's told you that XLRI is good only for HR, I think that's stupidity. XLRI is an excellent college to do a general MBA too. It is one of the best in the country to if you want to do an MBA in HR. So if I say what is the best college in India for an MBA in HR, it has to be XLRI. Yes. What about the city? Definitely XLRI Jamshedpur is what we're talking about. Yes, we will be talking about the whole test, how many sections and so on. How does that matter? Jamshedpur is tier 3. How does that matter? The college is there. So BM, yeah, we will talk about all which papers to practice and all. So you always just have to hold on. Let's talk about the questions which are there now on this slide. It is an excellent college for anything. So if anybody is looking at return on investment, I am right now talking only about XLRI. Yes, I would say XLRI BM will fall in the top 5 colleges of India to do an MBA, a general MBA, right? So I'm Ahmedabad, I'm Bangalore, I'm Calcutta, FMS, XLRI would be my top 5. He will get a, so if you get a 0 in GK, say, you will get a call from XLRI, but during your GDPI, those will be considered. Is a very good question somebody asked me, is ZAD CAT plus DM? Well, we'll talk a little bit about that. There are a few other things also except DM which are different. So we'll be talking about what all is different, so don't worry. So first important thing, a lot of people ask me, no sectional time limits within part A. Now let me explain this logic to you. Just because there is no sectional time limit does not mean that it makes life easier. In fact, sometimes it can make life very difficult. What happens is you get so carried away into a section that you forget there is one more section pending. So a lot of engineers who will take quant egoistically will get carried away in quant, start solving so much quant that what will happen is that they will forget that there is still verbal pending or whatever. You can decide which section you want to do first. There is the order of section is not important. Means it could be in the test, it could be say verbal, then DM and then quant. But you could start it whichever way you want because very frankly, it does not matter. Sectional cutoffs are present. So you have to clear sectional cutoffs. Without this, there is no way you're going to be able to clear things. You're not going to get a call. So what is our suggestion? Now this is our suggestion. Spend approximately 45 minutes. So how much is 45? 3s are 135. So spend approximately 135 minutes in this way, 45 minutes on each of the 3 sections, which means you've given equal importance. So you had totally 165 minutes. So you're still left with half an hour. Now, how do you choose the last half an hour? What do you do for that half an hour? There are 2 parts. One is trying to clear a sectional cutoff. Say most common problem you're going to have is DM. Okay, or for some people, verbal also. Now, let me explain to you, CAT, ZAT is a test. You know, over the years, we've seen that the students who get a ZAT call and who get a CAT call from the top IIMs, that subset is not always very clear cut. It's not that it's always all the students who got a CAT call also get a ZAT call or vice versa. Why does that happen? Why are there some students who don't get calls at CAT but still get calls at ZAT? Most important is verbal. Students who are good at verbal normally do well at ZAT. Because first of all, the verbal in ZAT is difficult. Second, even the decision-making section is now no more analytical. It used to be at a time. If I look at 11, 12, 13, even 15 ka paper, there used to be analytical questions also. Over the last couple of years, they've stopped asking analytical questions. So it's become more of a verbal area, you know? So students who are strong at verbal always do well at this section. And that is why it is all there. It's not a clear cut thing that, you know, number of students who get a call at ZAT or the students who get a call at ZAT have to be a subset of the ones who get a call at CAT. Or try and maximize your overall score through your best section. So if you feel that within the 45 minutes, you are able to going to be clear the DM cutoff. We'll talk about what the cutoff was. You know, if you're able to clear the DM cutoff, use your remaining time to maximize your overall score. Guys, remember, because if you clear three cutoffs, does not mean you will clear the overall cutoff. I'm sure you all know that by now, right? If you clear three cutoffs, you don't clear the overall cutoff. That is very, very obvious. Everybody should know that by now. So learn to maximize your score through your best section. So somebody who's an engineer says that your quant is my best section. Verbal DM, learn to manage, clear your cutoffs, maximize your score through quant. Anyway, number of questions are very high at quant. Right now, I'm just having a look at some questions. Okay, I'm coming to raw score, so you all will have to just wait. I think the questions are more or less same. Now, what should be your overall strategy? Practice mocks. Very, very obvious. You know, then what? You will find 5 full-length IMS ZAT mocks, 3 sectional decision-making tests at your IMS, in your MyIMS under test. Past 5 years ZAT papers. Now, this, according to me, is very, very, very important. Past 5 years ZAT papers. Learn. Now, you can't be skipping this. According to me, this will be a very, very important resource. So if a student is not an IMS student and could be doing mocks from anywhere else, I'm okay. They could be doing some other players' mocks. But the 5 ZAT papers become very, very important. Learn to do that. Because very frankly, you know, decision-making, how much ever anybody tries, it's very difficult to get into that, you know, what kind of decision-making will be asked. So the best thing would be to practice ZAT papers. GK compendium, we can take MyIMS GK zone exam wise. We have ZAT wise GK. Okay, now let's talk about section wise. And this is where your strategy, your study plan, everything comes in. So everybody now pay attention very carefully about what the study plan should be. Here I will also talk about the score versus percentile mapping. 26 questions. The logical reasoning, which they say, is not the CAT-wala logical reasoning. So please don't go and practice that. No family tree, no arrangements, no matrix, nothing of those sort. 14 RC questions last year, that is that 2028, were medium, 6 were difficult. Let me give you the breakup of RCs. Okay, 4 RCs with 4 threes are 12 questions here. And 1 poem RC. Yeah, this is a surprise. 1 into 2 questions. So, lot of times students fret a lot over the poem RC. Oh, the poem RC, that has a poem RC, and they go crazy over it. But understand, it's only 2 questions. I'm not saying hence you should blindly leave it. But there are 12 RC passages, 4 RC passages with 12 questions. What is the difference between RC passages in ZAT and CAT? The RC passages are slightly shorter in ZAT. You know, they don't have a lot of reading. But the options are pretty confusing and I would say slightly difficult. So definitely slightly difficult than CAT. So if you're telling me that CAT RCs you found difficult, ZAT RCs are going to be definitely one notch above that. You will learn that through the ZAT papers and through the mocks and everything. The poem RC, in fact, last year was not very, very difficult. So if somebody had attempted it smartly, so, you know, I was just speaking to my our verbal mentor and the logic was if you had seen the questions first, and then gone to the poem and looked at the poem with that perspective, you could have answered the poem RC also. Guys, you all are chatting now, you all are missing. I'm going to miss out your questions. You're wasting your own time. So don't put questions now. We'll take questions at the end. That will be much better for you all. Because I'm just missing out the questions which you all are putting now. my chat box is not even open. Inference-based questions. This is your LR, you know. So inference-based questions, strengthen and weaken argument, all these questions are always there, present in ZAT. 12 verbal ability or reasoning questions. Average level of difficulty would be medium. So somebody could say the verbal ability or the reasoning part is slightly easier than the RC. 6 CR. Now, this is very, very important. CR takes a big, big chunk of ZAT. Critical reasoning. In fact, critical reasoning is so important for ZAT because I even feel decision making is nothing but some part of CR only. Okay, it's a connected connection to CR. Exactly what I was just telling you. 2 parajumble, 2 fill in the blanks, 2 grammar. This will be 5 options, non-theta questions. So these will be 5 options, non-theta questions, right? Now understand that a lot of people think, oh, we have been practicing parajumbles for CAT with theta. So I really don't need to practice parajumbles. No, just because they have options does not make life very easy. Yes, it makes life a little bit easier. You definitely know that, you know, you don't have to start with a particular statement and so on. But still, the most obvious ones are not there. And the most, the ones we're going to get stuck with 2 options, those both options are going to be there. So please be very careful. Practice enough 5 options parajumbles. Just don't leave them. Last year, the 2 fill in the blanks were, I would say, easy to medium. This was the good part, where there is vocab and analogies and so on. 2 grammar questions also were easy to medium. So you can be doing these things very carefully. Don't miss this out. And that's your verbal section, right? Let's talk about the verbal and LR cutoff. Good attempts. So it was a 26 questions ka section. Good number of attempts are 15 to 17. Let's take an average of 16 questions, say, are good, which means you have skipped 8 questions, right? Don't worry about the skip questions, as I said. Please, at least one simple thing if you take back from today's session is that don't worry about the skip questions, and because of that, don't start attempting more questions. Expected cutoff, 8 to 10 marks at 80 percentile. So to get an 80 percentile, it is 8 to 10 marks. Even if I assume 9 marks, that is 9 questions correct without any negative marking, gives you 80 percentile. Also assume when you're trying to get scores that through the skip marks, you will get a negative 1 in verbal 2, right? In verbal, so whatever is your cutoff, and if you feel that you are reaching that cutoff, understand you are going to need 1 more mark because you will get 1 negative from skip questions in every section approximately. I'm not saying exactly, but approximately. Because if I attempt 15 questions over here and same way if I attempt 15 questions in all section, DM 15 will be very difficult. So you will land up with roughly 30-35 non-attempted questions. So you should keep that in mind, and mentally you should make a note that you need 1 extra mark to clear cutoffs. Right? Now that was about the verbal section. I can take a couple of questions around verbal. Point 1 is for 1 question. Ritik, I explained in the start, I think you joined late, Ritik, that overall if you will get 3 negative, you will approximately get negative 1 in verbal. So how do you practice verbal? Now, for me, practicing verbal is, if I look at it, let's assume you're prepared for CAT. Just wait, everybody. Yeah, I'll give you the one, just wait. So now, if I look at what should you practice in verbal, my thought is that if you were a good student in CAT, say your verbal was good, then RC, you don't really need to worry too much. You can do poem RCs. If you've done enough RCs throughout the year, I would say you don't have to worry too much. Obviously, since you're going to solve the mocks and the ZAT papers, that much extra practice will be there. So if you're solving 10 papers, also bare minimum. I'm saying bare minimum, somebody should solve 10 papers. 5 mocks and 5 actual ZATs. Bare minimum. So 10 fours are 40 more RCs. So you're doing anyways a 5 option. I think that should be comfortable to help you navigate the 5 option thing. Practice CR really well. Critical reasoning, according to me, is the important part of ZAT that makes or breaks somebody's verbal section. Okay? So please see that you do that really well. practice grammar because that is what you've not done earlier. I'm sorry for that. Yeah, practice grammar because that is something which you've not done for CAT. And vocab, if you've been appearing for NMAT, so if you plan your NMAT and you practice vocab for NMAT, I think that should be comfortably enough for that also. But somebody who's been not writing NMAT, then will need to do vocab separately. Okay? Parajumbles, you will practice some T-towers. Utkash, I'll try and put your thought to somebody else. So you will have a lot of how to do vocab. You have cards. You can use cards. You can use apps. There are so many apps. How to do grammar. Very frankly, guys, those are very, very specific verbal questions. I would suggest you go back to your mentors for that. So see, one thing is very simple. Guys, if you're going to keep crying about, you know, that what happened in CAT, you're going to spoil your other exams also. Let me tell you that, you know, even though y'all feel that the CAT was very bad for y'all, I'll tell you it won't be that bad when the percentiles come out, because for the CAT was bad for everybody. So just to give you a perspective how bad the CAT was for somebody who scored a 100 percentile last year in quant. I know somebody who scored a 100 percentile in quant last year, came out of the test and said, this is one CAT I want to forget. No, I'm not. Scrabbler still did excellent, Vidhu. Scrabbler is very different. He still did excellent. So very frankly, don't think so much about CAT. Tanya, I didn't. It wasn't that bad for me, the quant section especially. I did decently well, but yes, it was nowhere compared to what it was like last year. Yeah, I agree with Neeraj. We should not talk about CAT. Let's forget your CAT. So let's just forget CAT for a second and let's concentrate on the remaining exam because you're going to waste too much time on that. I would not skip vocab. I would at least learn vocab a little bit because the two questions last year were pretty manageable. Okay, I'm going ahead now. So somebody wanted to take... Yeah, Barron's will be a good source for vocab. A lot of people ask me, is Barron's a good source for vocab? It's a decent source. Right? Can we go ahead? Yeah, this now becomes your make or break section, as we said. 21 questions. The biggest problem is, you know, 7 cases. Now, I have kept around 45 to 50 minutes for this section. In 45 to 50 minutes to answer 7 cases is very, very difficult. So you need to learn to shortlist your cases based on what the thought of the passage or the case is. Now, what is the areas which they test? So ethical dilemma is definitely one. Now, ethical dilemma, most of the time, I would say more than 90% of the time, you always, whenever there is an ethical dilemma, whether it is now in DM or later on during GDPI, during the interview, you always have to be on the right side of ethical dilemma. You know, wherever there is ethics involved, you always have to be on the right side of the ethics. You can't be saying that, oh, I will break ethics to do well somewhere. So that is what ethical dilemma is. So always remember that ethical dilemma is always one area which you have to be careful about. So questions can be based around that somebody has done this, you know, he has withheld information from the company before joining the company. Now you know about his crime record or past record. How would you treat it? He's your good friend. How would you treat it? Could be an example. Business decisions could be questions around, say, for example, you need to open an ice cream parlor in a particular area. This is the information about that area, weather conditions, pandemic conditions. I'm sure, I'm not saying that definitely, but there is very high chances that they can ask you one passage or one case around this pandemic or something like that. So taking a business decision, is it a good thing to open it here or open it there? Which place will be good? Should you open this business or the other business and so on? So basically somebody put a question, ethical dilemma versus a business decision. Always stay on the side of ethics. You can never go on the side of business decision by overcoming ethics. You can't say I will do something wrong, I will bribe somebody, but I will do my business well. Anvai will be, yeah, I think there are some couple of video lectures of decision making already available. Tony sir had done a last time a couple of questions. Also, we'll be doing two ZAT mocks videos we'll be doing. So you should get that also. You don't need GK. Okay, lot of people think that, you know, these questions, you know, the decision making questions are very logical. If you have experience and if you have business sense, you'll be able to answer them well. Might be, but understand, finally, the answer is in the passage. They've given you a passage and the answer is in the passage. Okay, we can try and do that. Somebody asked a very good point, sir. Can you do a 2020 ka paper ka solution? We will do it. Chalo. I am committing from my side that we will do the ZAT 2020 paper ka video solution. Okay. Why have we, even though there is no mathematical DM for last 2 years, you will still find that we still have some, in some of the mocks, we still have mathematical DM, because I don't tell you, or I'm not telling you that next year or this year there will be no DM with mathematics. You can't just say, you know, that what happened for the last 2 years will not happen this year. So for example, look at CAT this year, hardly any maximum minima questions were there in the last 2 years. This time so many maximum minima questions. Yes, PNC probability. I'll come to quant. No, why are we jumping to quant? So ethics and morals are very, very similar. If you are on the right side of morals, you're automatically on the right side of ethics. Yeah, DM cutoffs you're coming to. So when we talk about mathematical dilemma, DM questions, is that in decision making, they always give you a case where there are numbers. And based on the numbers, you have to take a decision whether you would do a particular business. What decision will you take? See, finally, DM is, you know, there is a problem. And you have to take a decision to solve that problem. It's always about that. Yes, in fact, a lot of DM questions are based on which of the three statements would you select, which will help you understand this case. So they'll give you a question, they'll give you a case, and there'll be five options. And out of the five options, you have to select three of them. And the options have that. So there are five statements. Out of the five statements, three are correct, and so on. Practice, very frankly. No, they don't include too much questions related to shares. Good attempts, 14 to 15, which will still tell you to attempt five cases, right? So your plan has to be attempt five cases. Expected cutoff, 7.5 to 8.5. If I consider 8.5 and what we spoke about, the negative, which you will get through skip questions, you should plan to get close to around 10 marks or at least 9.5 marks, right? Very frankly, this is not an area which you should look into be maximizing your score through, unless you've been doing excellent at DM in your mocks and that papers, which will be, I think, not even half a percentile of half a percent of the students. Not an area which you should look to maximize your score through. Also, number of questions are lesser, 21. So no point maximizing your score through this section. Sectional difficulty, we are being very, very clear, upfront, very difficult. No hiding behind the bush, no telling you, oh, you can manage it. No flowery language. It is a difficult section. Period. Very unique section. You don't see it anywhere else. So you've not practiced it throughout the year. This 1 month becomes very, very important. You are close to a month from today. Very, very important it becomes. Difficult to clear cutoff in designated time. So that 45 minutes, which we had said, it might be difficult to clear cutoffs in this. Hence, out of that extra half an hour which you have, a lot of students, I don't say you should do it, but a lot of students put close to 15 minutes here. And then they put 15 minutes in their favorite section to maximize the score. See, normally 45 minutes are easy to clear cutoff of verbal and quant. Quant, definitely. Verbal also, you can clear the sectional cutoffs in 45 minutes if you're decently good at verbal. Because grammar, vocab does not take you time. Very frankly, questions like grammar and vocab, you either know them or you don't know them. So you move ahead very quickly, right? So they don't take a lot of time. So 45 minutes are good enough to clear the cutoffs. But decision making, 45 minutes can be sometimes less to clear cutoffs. And hence, that extra half an hour which you are left with, 15 minutes you can easily use for decision making. So out of the 3 hours, you're approximately using 1 hour for decision making is what a lot of students are doing. Okay. We spoke about percentile and everything. Your scores are there. Anybody needs to take a snapshot can take it. Yes, this video recording will be available. See, you have enough decision-making practice on the IMS website. There are workshops. So that you can use all that you can use. No visual reasoning does not come in that. Okay, going ahead. The QA and DI section. 28 questions. Now, this is very, very, very important. Everybody, please pay attention here. Two doable DI sets. If somebody is asking me, sir, what would you do if you went to CAT? Even with all my knowledge of quant, I would still attempt DI first in ZAT. Because I think that the level of DI, after solving the level of DI for CAT, this DI is much easier. So hence, if I was good, even decently good with DI and CAT, I will be able to do this DI. It should not be very difficult, is my thought. So about 3 questions each, so total of 6 questions, I would try and attend them. See, obviously, I would go through them first. That doesn't mean that even if they're difficult, I'm going to solve them. So on a particular day, if that ZAT DI set is very difficult, it makes no sense because there's no calculator, right? I am sure you all know that there is no calculator. So because there is no calculator, I will not blindly attempt a DI set if it is calculation intensive, right? But definitely doable DI compared to even CAT. Yes, sometimes. No on-screen calculator. I just said that. Again, people are asking on-screen calculator. Everything has 5 options. Why quant? Everything has 5 options. Okay? 22 QA questions. Use DI to clear sectional cutoffs. That's very, very important. Sectional level of difficulty, moderately difficult. Not as difficult as verbal and DM. Now, this was the breakup last year. 7 questions in arithmetic. This, I still think, yes, there will be data sufficiency. You should practice data sufficiency. Everybody just pay attention 1 second to this. 7 questions in arithmetic. I'll come back to the first slide. Now, I still think like CAT, arithmetic becomes your make and break section. How many people over here don't like time, speed, distance? I'm just counting. So around 15 people have already said they don't like time, speed, distance. I think you'll realize the mistake in CAT. So once, guys who love it, please don't answer. You'll realize your mistake because you all did not practice time speed distance too well. You'll realize the mistake in CAT. CAT already had so much time speed distance. And I feel even in that, the 7 questions of arithmetic, I would not stick my neck out, but I would say at least 2 questions will be on TSD. Devam, you'll be very surprised to know how many people don't like arithmetic. I would put the overall quant one notch above CAT. What will be the difficulty level? So whatever difficulty level you practiced for CAT, you will have to go above that. So for example, CAT now hardly sees any remainder questions. One area I would definitely want to look at. No, TSD comes under arithmetic. Second, they hardly have questions around last 2 digits. Do you all know the whole concept? Yeah, probability will be asked, which will come to modern maths. clocks and calendars very rare. So arithmetic will be your regular time, speed, distance, time and work, ratios, profit and loss, simple interest, compound interest, and so on. So geometry, extra, what would I do? Except what I've done in CAT, I would do trigo in a little bit more detail. So except knowing the ratios, I would want to know a little bit extra. Maybe, you know, for people who are aware of what trigonometry is, I would do sine 2a, cos 2a, and a couple of more identities and so on. Yes, I would do installment-based questions. Set theory I would go through. Why not? Venn diagram is always an area which every test taker likes. Okay? So geometry, so besides CAT, I would do trigo really well. I would do everything what I've done for CAT. E-maximizer should be good. ZAT paper should be good. Guys, you all can go back to ZAT. See, anybody who feels that they have done enough practice for ZAT, you can keep going back to ZAT 2008. If you go back to ZAT 2008, there are 13 years ka papers available. So very frankly, I don't think so you have a problem with where should I practice from. Just practice more and more ZAT papers. You really want to feel demotivated, practice 2011 ZAT. 2011-12, one of the worst ZAT papers. No, Akriti, I would not leave geometry completely. Yeah, you can use some of the CAT sections, but I would prefer that you do ZAT papers. Only if you finished all the ZAT tests and all the ZAT mocks, then go to CAT papers back again. So I would still, if you're not good at quant also, I would still do DI well. So let's take this now for those students. Yeah, I would go from 15 to 20. Practicing my ZAT papers, I would go from 15 to 20. 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20 would be my pattern. And if I've done with all of them, then I would go to 14 and all, if I still have time. Now, for students who are not good with quant, just give me a minute, everybody. How would you prepare for? Everybody stop chatting. Let's talk about the students who are not very good with quant. How do you prepare? I would do arithmetic really well. I would do at least basics of geometry well, like doing mensuration well, knowing all your formulas, circle, properties, everything I would do well. I would do probability. That's one area which, you know, ZAT will always test you on. And then basics of algebra, at least know your quadratic and linear and everything. Yes, Neha, you should always practice anything time-based. Logs, last year there were a couple of questions. I think one question, but not too much. It will come under numbers or modern maths, whichever way you want to put it. Okay. So I'm just going ahead now. QA and DI cutoff. Number of attempts 17 to 19. Total number of questions were 28. 11 to 13 marks is the cutoff. For students who are good, also the percentile is higher. So if you are aiming at HR, your percentile will come out lower. So don't worry too much. HR cutoffs are much lower for quant. Okay, so that was quant cutoffs. Please take down. Then after that, we'll go to overall cutoffs. And then we'll come back to general questions. Okay, so expected cutoffs, as we said in quant, will be around 11 to 13. Overall cutoffs. XLRI BM 35 to 36 marks, which if you notice is approximately slightly more, very, very close to 50% of the paper. So this is approximately 50% of the paper. Now you have to base, so somebody was asking me, sir, how much it should be the accuracy. Now understand, look at your accuracy levels and understand how much do you need to attempt to reach 35, 36. And that is how you look at it. XLRI HM is your 99 percentile is between 42 to 45 marks. It's a very, very good test for those students who are good with accuracy and slightly slower in life. You know, who like, so for example, they don't like a speed-based exam. This is not really a speed-based exam. This is an exam where, you know, for example, if I look at quant, I know I want to attempt 17 to 18 questions. I have close to 1 hour. Not exactly 1 hour, but close to 1 hour. I want to attempt 17 to 18 questions. Can I attempt that with decent accuracy level? I think yes. That's how you have to look at it. Because out of the 17 to 18 questions in quant, 6 are DI. which we have already said is doable. You need 12 more in quant. Out of 12 in which you need in quant, I'm telling you, even in ZAT, and I'm not kidding, you will still find three sitters, maybe even four, but there'll be still three sitters. Questions which are very straightforward. They are not really difficult, straight concept-based questions and so on. So it's a simple logic. If you've attempted this, say, in 10 to 12 minutes, and you've attempted this in 5 minutes, you have good amount of time to crack 9 questions. And then just pick up your favorite areas and start cracking those 9 questions. Yeah, I am completely saying, Karishma, that ZAT quant is difficult. Nobody's even saying that it is easy. But still, you will find three sitters, is what I'm saying. So why not? You know, so I think Rahul asked me, sir, how do I manage to do 10 mocks in 1 month? Now, which means we're saying 10 mocks in 1 month, which means saying 3 mocks in 3 days, 1 mock. Is that too difficult to complete 10 mocks in 1 month? I don't think so. Because very frankly, tell me at this time of the year. So Rahul, with other exams, so very frankly, what other exams? So when we talk about NMAT, very frankly, NMAT, if you have already taken one attempt, you're more or less there. You're not, if you're studying for ZAT quant, very frankly, you're not studying too much for CAT quant, NMAT quant, right? Verbal RCs are going to be very easy. Vocab, which you will study, will help you in both of them. Just everybody, yeah, recording is available. So just everybody, 1 minute, sit down. Sitters are very, very easy question, Banu. Yes, I would suggest you should give past papers like mocks. Just everybody, can you hold on to your questions first, please? Just wait. Just hold on to your questions. So now simple logic is that whatever you're planning. So a lot of people ask me, sir, how do I plan SNAP studies with NMAT studies? Very frankly, if you studied for NMAT, there is hardly anything extra you need to do for SNAP. If you're prepared for NMAT, SNAP should be a subset of that. Now, let's talk about ZAT. What are you studying for ZAT? Now, if I look at ZAT, you are saying that you're studying extra RCs, critical reasoning, decision making. I would say from whatever time you're spending studying from here onwards to ZAT, at least 35 to 40% of the time should go for decision making. Okay, 35 to 40% time should go for decision making. 15 to 20, or another 30% time should go for RCs and CR, mainly for CR. 10% time to do grammar, vocab, and extra. If you're not prepared for NMAT, slightly more. And last part, the 20-25% time left off will go in quant, where mainly you will practice the other areas. Unless you know you are bad at quant and CAT also, you can increase the time a little bit. So this is a general student who was good at CAT and now is targeting ZAT. Okay, I think 10 mocks should be taken. Now see, it's okay if you take one NMAT in a day and next day if you take a ZAT, no? NMAT mock on say a Monday and then Tuesday if you take a ZAT mock should not manage too much. So I would start my mocks after 10 days. First 10 days, I would prepare decision-making, do decision-making really well, practice a little bit of CR, and then go for mocks is the other way I would do it. And then do, so I've given you the weightage of algebra, 2 or 3 questions last 2 years. Okay, let's move ahead. And now part B, the GK section. 25 questions is generally difficult. Approximately 65 to 70%. Static GK. And the remaining 30-35%, yeah, exactly what we're saying, is 7 to 8 is current affairs GK. Does not count towards that percentile. Prep plan summary, work on developing. So this is your total prep plan summary for ZAT, not for GK. Huh? Work on developing verbal ability, very important. Increase your reading speed. Practice decision making. I think this is, lot of people take decision making very lightly. I'll give you the GK slide again. Just give me a second. Everybody takes decision making very lightly. And they think finally, either I will get it or I will not get it. It doesn't work that way. You will get decision making only if you practice. So I have said there are 7 cases in every mock, which means if you're practicing 10 mocks, it is 70 cases of good practice, plus at least another 30. I should say you should have practiced 100 cases of decision making by the time DM comes. That should be your target. Resources, we've already said this. My IMS channel, videos, that workshops are there. Please have a look at these workshops. Everybody have a look at this. ADMAT workshops. So somebody was asking me, sir, Tony sir's decision making videos. They are over here in the ADMAT workshops. Yes, you can prepare for IFT after that. Also, I have done the quant workshops also ka videos. So you will find quant workshop videos also. Vivek, I don't know what you mean by free for everyone. If you're an IMS student, it is free for you. Practice a bit of GK every day. Here it says 8. I would still say 10. I would say 5 ZAT, pass ZAT papers. Okay, new videos. I might, as I said, we are definitely doing 2 mock ka videos, ZAT 102 and ZAT 103. These 2 videos we are doing, definitely. Plus, I plan to do a video or concept video on last 2 digits. And as I promised today, ZAT 2020 ka video. When will the percentile be uploaded? They've already given a date on their website. Please go through the base. For basic questions, go through website. Yeah. You know, you all have to learn at least. E-Maximizer is for CAT mainly, but there are some older CAT papers which are difficult, which will help you in that also. Questions don't repeat. Workshops and all are over here. I've already put down filter in categories, ADMAT workshops. We've already put the list down. GK, go through Compendium, which is there on our website. So a lot of people said they wanted to go through the GK section once more. This is a GK part. All past ZAT papers are available on IMS website also. All that is later, whether it gives importance to WorkEx and all will come later. The call comes on percentile. Somebody wants a quant breakup slide. Yeah, this was the quant breakup slide. This video will be available now. Can we go on to the questions now? This video is available on recording on YouTube also. I'm going on to questions now. I think we are... Okay, so this was the part of how much can IMS help you. For students who are not registered IMS students, this is what you can get. So with the ADMAT self-learning program, what all do you get? We gave all our cutoffs of XLRI, everything we gave. So all those who joined in late and don't know what the cutoff for XLRI and all are there, they are there on the first stage. Okay, now let's take only questions and let's take them a little bit slowly. So we can answer these questions. That self-learning program is also there. And there's a PGDBA self-learning program coming up for students who want to look at PGDBA. I am not answering questions today around TIS, CMAT and all. You all can put them up somewhere else and they'll be answered. Importance of GK and PA, PI, very frankly, they don't announce it very clearly. But they do look at the scores is what has been told us. A good score would be around 6 to 7 in GK, according to me. So now that's off with the presentation on my side. Okay, thanks a lot, everybody. Bye. Have a nice day. Best of luck.